There are two numbers that every gardener should know for the best success in the garden. So let's discuss those numbers today. Your hardiness zone and the length of your growing season. Hi, I'm Gardener Scott, and I'm sitting in the middle of my Colorado Zone 5B vegetable garden. It's the middle of winter right now, and as you can see, I don't have much growing in this vegetable garden. But the fact that I'm in Zone 5B and that I'm not growing any vegetables do not correlate at all. It doesn't matter what zone I'm in when it comes to my vegetables. Instead, it's my growing season that identifies for me when I can grow vegetables. It might be helpful to think of the hardiness zone as a winter number and your growing season as a summer number. And I know this often causes confusion, particularly for new gardeners. The hardiness zone is based on the average lowest winter temperature. In my case, it's minus 15 degrees Fahrenheit, which puts me in zone 5B. Hardiness zone is most often used to identify what type of perennials and shrubs and trees that you can grow in your landscape. What type of plants can handle the lowest temperature that you have on average. When it comes to our vegetable gardens, we're also concerned about low temperatures. But instead, it's when the low temperatures end and when the low temperatures begin again. So a growing season is defined as the last frost date in spring as its beginning and the first frost date in fall as its end. All that time in between when we don't have cold weather is when we can have our vegetable garden. Wouldn't it be nice if gardening were so easy that we could identify those two numbers and everything else falls into place? It's easy with the hardiness zone. It's based on historical climatological data. I'm in zone 5B based on averages over the last 30 plus years. My growing season number is 134 days. From my average last frost on May 15th to my average first frost on September 26th is 134 days. So in general, as I'm deciding what plants to put in my garden, I use 134 days as my target. In many seasons, it's actually closer to 105 days. The weather in Colorado can be quite unpredictable. There is a 10% chance that we will have a frost after May 30th. And there's also a 10% chance that we will have a frost before September 13th. Well, it's 105 days from May 30th to September 13th. And most experienced gardeners in my area don't put their warm season plants like their peppers and their eggplants and their tomatoes in the garden until the very last weekend of May. I usually target June 1st. So for those of us that have been doing it for a while, the averages say we have 134 days to grow everything we want. But in practice, we find that those late freezes come often enough that it's better to play it safe. So for me, 105 days is really more accurate for my growing season. And so as I look through catalogs and when I go to the store to buy seed packets, I keep in mind my 105 day growing season. Because if I choose seeds that are going to take longer than that, well, the possibility exists that a frost will hit and I won't be able to get a harvest. And that's happened a lot in my gardening career. And it's not just as simple as 105 days, because when you look in a catalog and you see something like this mountain sweet yellow watermelon, it says it's 100 days. Well, that means after the plant has started growing, and if the conditions are near perfect, you can expect to have a harvest in 100 days. Well, most of my melons I direct sow from seed, so it's going to take a week, maybe more, for them to germinate. 100 days plus just 7 days of germination and growth is 107, which puts me outside my growing window. If everything is perfect, I might get a crop of that watermelon, but probably not. So instead, I would look at something like a sugar baby. That is 80 days to harvest. So now I can sow the seed, get it growing, and I should have 80 days in my season to be able to get to the harvest. I like to play it safe even more, and so I'll buy something like this Blacktail Mountain watermelon that is only 75 days to harvest. This is how you can use the length of your growing season to your advantage, is choosing the plants that will give you the best chance for a harvest. So, for instance, I wanted to grow some popcorn this year. Well, I can look in here and there's a strawberry popcorn that is 100 to 105 days to harvest. Again, really playing it close to the length of my growing season. So instead, I went ahead and got this snow puff popcorn that is only an 85-day variety. Understanding your growing season, the length of your growing season, and what you want to grow makes a difference. I don't grow a lot of big beefsteak tomatoes. Instead, I grow something like Sun Gold, which is expected to be ready in 65 days, or Gold Nugget, which I can harvest after 70 days. Kellogg's Breakfast kind of pushes my limits a little bit. It's an 85-day variety. But if things go well, I can get a harvest. I really don't like being limited by a short growing season. So 105 days is definitely too short, and even 134 days can be too short. But we can change those numbers, and I do that at every opportunity. When we talk about a growing season, as I've been discussing it so far, we're talking about planting in open beds, either raised beds or in the ground that are exposed to all of the weather that we might have, particularly the low temperatures. But if we use some very simple techniques, we can extend our growing season and get a much longer period of time for us to grow our plants and not be limited by a number like 105 or 134. Doesn't 152 sound better? For me to have a 152-day growing season out in my vegetable garden, well, without much work, I can make that happen. All of these earlier dates and numbers that I've been talking about have been based on frost dates, with frost being 36 degrees Fahrenheit, because peppers and tomatoes and similar plants can be damaged, if not killed, when the temperatures get down below 36 degrees Fahrenheit. Instead, I can look at my freeze dates. So my last average freeze is May 4th, and my first average freeze is October 3rd. That's 152 days. So if I can just give my plants a little bit extra protection so that the air around the plants increases from 32 degrees to 36 degrees, I can lengthen my growing season. And getting the plants warmer isn't that hard to do. I have videos that show some of that, where I have hoops over these beds with plastic, or I use a wall of water, or a cloche. You can use cold frames that are like little mini greenhouses. These are ways to extend the season and make it longer. And in my case, it's just a couple weeks on the front side and a couple weeks on the back side. And I can have 152 days to grow what I want. You can use the same calendar calculations to determine your growing season. I use three different numbers depending on what I'm planning to grow. You can easily focus on a single number. So for me, 134 days is how long I tell people my growing season is. But when it comes to practice, I usually use 105 days in deciding which seeds I'm going to start and what plants I'm going to grow, because most of my garden is not under hoops and is not protected. But when I do want to grow those things that take more growing time, I'll take the effort to protect them because I want the harvest. And to get the harvest, I need a longer growing season. So I have to make an artificial growing season with all of those season extenders. Most of the focus on any discussion about the growing season is on those plants that can't handle any frost at all, because those are the ones that are most commonly grown in home gardens. It's the cucumbers and the tomatoes and the pumpkins and the melons. They can't handle a frost. But we do need to recognize that there are many plants that we can grow that can handle some frost. They can handle some freezing conditions, like this Swiss chard. It says that we can sow it as soon as the soil can be worked, which means before the last frost date. And this kale specifically says to sow outdoors shortly before the last frost date. It's much more difficult to define the length of the growing season when you consider growing some of these type of plants. So we'll still keep the definition the same for these warm season plants. But if you're growing kale and chard and spinach and those kind of plants that can handle the cold, you lengthen your entire growing time. And if you throw that extra protection in, you lengthen it even more. I've found my average dates and then determined my growing seasons based on what it is I'm planning on growing with some simple searches on the internet. And I've got some links below in the description that can help you on your search. Now, these are guides for the United States through the National Weather Service. But if you're in a country besides the states, you'll have similar resources. The climatological data for your area and your country will give you a good idea of how long your growing season is. Now, of course, this is also determinant on whether you get frost and freeze at all. If you're in an area that isn't exposed to frost or freeze, or if you are for a very brief period of time, then much of this really doesn't matter as much as those of us that have freezing winter conditions. But the concepts are still basically the same. You should identify the length of time that you're going to be growing. So while I'm limited by winter conditions, you might be limited by summer conditions. My brother lives in Arizona, a very hot southwestern state in the United States. They can't grow a vegetable garden during the summer because it's too hot. The same factors come into play. Instead of looking at your average last frost and first frost, you can kind of reverse it. And instead, look at when your temperatures begin to exceed 90 degrees Fahrenheit. Because above that temperature, you're not going to get the pollination and the plants are going to suffer. Establish your growing season based on frost or heat as you then decide what plants you can grow. And so a guideline of whether you should plan your growing season based on your heat or your cold does come back to your hardiness zone. Because remember, hardiness zones are based on the lowest winter temperatures. So if you're in a zone 9 or a zone 10 in the United States or a similar zone in Australia where you have very hot summers, the frost dates really don't matter, but you still should figure out what your growing season is. If you're in a zone 5 like me, or a 6 or a 7 where you're going to be exposed to freezing conditions, well, now you'd establish your growing season based on the last frost and the first frost. The hardiness zones really don't matter when it comes to the vegetables we're going to grow, but they do play a factor in helping you to identify whether you need to figure out the length of your growing season or not. And as I began with, these are very important numbers. I know I'm in zone 5 with a 134-day growing season. That can get me started in planning out what I'm going to grow, where I'm going to put it, and how long I have until the harvest has to come in when the season's going to change in fall. If you want to learn more about growing plants for any growing season, be sure to check out the many videos I have in the Gardener Scott video library. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel, go ahead and do so now, and be sure to click on the bell so you're notified when new videos and live streams come out every week. I'm Gardener Scott. Enjoy gardening.